It's just a very simple illustration of the economics of trust. If you can increase trust, you'll increase speed and decrease cost. There's some risk in that. You've got to be smart about it. But there's also huge return to it. There's risk in not doing it. You look at the customers you're losing, not doing it. Now, it applies everywhere, and the data on it is overwhelming. High trust is a dividend, just as surely as low trust is a tax. Now I'd like you to identify a second person. This time identify someone that you work with and need to work with, but with whom you have a low trust relationship. For whatever reason, you need to work together, trust is low. Again, it could be a direct report, or a peer, or a colleague, or a board member, or a supplier, distributor, partner, a customer. But you need to work together, trust is low. Okay? Now with this person in mind, let me ask you the same questions and jot down the top of mind one-word type answers that come to you. What's it like to work with this person with whom there's low trust? Go ahead and write it down. What's it like to communicate with them? How long does it take to get things done? And what kind of results are you able to achieve? All right, now here's what I'd like you to do. In just a moment, I'm going to have you pair up with a learning partner at your table. Two of you, possibly three, depending on the numbers. And you don't need to share the names of the people that you wrote down, just in case you wrote down the name of the person sitting next to you. But, of course, they'd be on the high trust side, right? But that's not the purpose. But what I'd like you to do is just take a minute between the two of you and describe the difference in these two relationships. Describe the difference in working with someone with whom there's low trust versus working with someone with whom there is high trust. Okay? So introduce yourself if you need to. Describe the difference in these two relationships. 60 seconds. Thank you. So let me ask this question. Is there a difference in these relationships? Absolutely. Is this a small difference or is it a huge difference? It's huge. And literally everything flows from it. Everything's dependent upon it. And we all know it. We've all been there. Do you think if you wanted to, you could put an economic price tag on the value in this of this difference? I think that you could, and I'll show you how in just a moment. But everything's affected by it. And we've all been there. We all have high trust relationships and probably a few low trust relationships. And the difference is palpable. And I'll argue it is economic. Let's just take as an example communication. Communication. In a high trust relationship, what is communication like? Easy. Open. Inviting. Clear. Inspiring. So stimulating. It's real, right? It's all these things, absolutely natural, authentic, engaging. You're dealing with the real issues. You trust each other. See, my experience is this. In a high trust relationship, you can be very, you can sometimes almost say the wrong thing and people will still get your meaning because they know you, they trust you. Trust fills in the gap. They know your intent, your motive. Now let's contrast that. How about communication in a low trust relationship? What is that like? Terrible. Hazardous. Stressful, strained, burdened. Yeah, meetings within meetings. There's hidden meetings. And see, absolutely all these things. You're calculated, guarded. There's withholding. There's gamesmanship. You're not quite sure. What's the agenda here? What's the motive? My experience is all of these things, but also this. In a low trust relationship, you could be very measured and even precise in your communication. And people will still misinterpret you, read things into it, project their agenda, because they don't trust you, see, or you don't trust them. Communication is far more a matter of trust than it is technique, although technique matters. Trust matters infinitely more. And one reason why legal communication is so expensive and time-consuming is because fundamentally, in most cases, it's based upon low trust. In some cases, no trust. As a result, it takes a lot of time, costs a lot of money. You might say that the very definition of a bad relationship is low trust. So, and we've been there. We've all been there. We know this. We know this intuitively. But what I want to give you today is this pair of glasses to take what you intuitively know to be able to do something about it. Now, there's another reason why getting good at trust is so vital today for entrepreneurs. And that's because of the environment in which we're operating. We're operating in a low-trust world, and it's becoming increasingly lower trust. We need to be aware of that. That's context. Let me share with you some data. I'll go through this data very quickly. Societal trust. Low trust is everywhere. It begins in our society. Only 34% of Americans believe that other people can be trusted. 1 in 3. Used to be much higher. It's come down. In Great Britain, by the way, this number is 29%. It had been 60% just a few decades ago. But there's been a precipitous decline in trust. In other parts of the world, it's lower. In Latin America, 23%. Africa as a continent, 18%. In some countries, it's as low as 6%. A basic societal trust of, can other people be trusted? There's other parts of the world, Scandinavia, Denmark, Sweden, and Norway, in which it's 68%, much higher. But the point is this. In the U.S., it's 30, it's low, and it's getting lower. Look at this other measure. Trust in many institutions sits at historic lows. By institutions, I mean trust in media, trust in government, trust in political parties, trust in large companies, trust in churches and education. It's generally gone down quite a bit. And in some cases, it is sitting at historic all-time lows. And it makes you suddenly question, who can you trust? How can you trust? But the reality is, trust has gone down for many reasons, and they can be good reasons. Look at this. Trust is low in our organizations. This is data coming out of traditional organizations. Only 49% of employees trust their senior leaders, less than half. And only 36% of employees believe that their top managers act with honesty and integrity. And 76% of employees observed a high level of illegal or unethical conduct at work in the prior 12 months. If that conduct becomes exposed, you end up with a scandal. Finally, let's look at even individuals coming out of schools. This is the percentage of students who acknowledge that they cheated in order to improve their odds of getting into graduate school. 43% of liberal arts students. 52% of education students. 63% of law and medical students. And 75% of business students. Now, I was with a group of attorneys, just a few, I guess it's been a year or so ago, in Dallas. And these attorneys were thrilled that they were not in last place. And they chided me because I had an MBA that I was in last place. Now, speaking of MBAs, look at this data. 76% were willing to understate expenses in order to not cut into company profits. And convicts in minimum security prisons scored higher on their ethical dilemma exam than did the MBAs. All of which makes you ask this question, you know, who do you trust? I was with a group the other day and someone raised their hand and yelled out, convicts. That's who you trust. Who do you trust? See, let me define trust briefly. By trust, I simply mean confidence. Confidence. The opposite of that, distrust, is suspicion. Distrust is suspicion. See, I don't trust someone if I'm suspicious about their agenda or their motive, or if I'm suspicious about their integrity, or suspicious about their capabilities, their results. I do trust when I feel confidence. It's like someone said, I could give you a dictionary definition of trust, but you know it when you feel it. And what you feel is confidence as opposed to suspicion. Here's the danger of the low trust all around us, including with government and everything else. It's because we see it and we start to say we got to protect ourselves. We see a scandal happen. We wonder what else is out there. When's the other shoe going to drop? We become a little bit more cynical and a little bit more jaundiced towards this, questioning, wondering, rightfully so, because we're aware of this. We don't want to get burned, taken advantage of. Well, it can become a vicious downward cycle of distrust and suspicion. Because here's the challenge, my friends. When you go into a new relationship, and you extend distrust to begin with, you know what? How people respond? They reciprocate, and they distrust back. And we get into a vicious downward cycle of distrust and suspicion, creating the very thing that we're fearing, more distrust and suspicion. And that's the danger of this environment. But here's the great news. A leader, an entrepreneur, someone that knows how to establish, grow, create trust in a world of distrust has a huge advantage. Because in the same way that it can get into a vicious downward cycle, it can also become an upward, virtuous cycle, like Warren Buffett has done. Because of his credibility and trust, he's able to create more and establish more. People respond to it. They rise to the occasion. They become better because of it. And he gets into a virtuous upward cycle of trust and confidence, creating more trust and confidence. And they get the fruits, the dividends that flow from that. So who do you trust is an important question. We ask and answer it every day. But here's a more important one, my friends, that's more vital than this first one. It's to put a mirror up to that one and ask this question. Who trusts you? Who trusts you? Does your team trust you? Do your partners trust you? Do your customers trust you? Do your investors trust you? Does your family trust you? Do you know the answer to this? Could you know? Should you know? Does it matter? See, I suggest that it does matter, and it matters enormously. If trust were simply a social virtue, you might say, hey, it doesn't matter. But it's not just a social virtue. It's also economic. It's affecting the speed and the cost of everything else in your business. Let me show you a brief DVD clip that just begins to quantify the high cost of low trust. Trust always affects two measurable outcomes, always, speed and cost. When trust goes down in a relationship, on a team, with a customer, in a company, when trust goes down, speed goes down with it, cost goes up. This is a tax, a low trust tax. Now, thankfully, the converse is true as well. When trust goes up in any relationship, on a team, in a company, with a client, when trust goes up, speed goes up and cost comes down. After the terrorist attacks of 9/11, our trust or confidence in flying in this country went down, naturally. So we took steps to compensate for the lack of trust. We beefed up security. It's helped. But it comes at a price. Takes longer, costs more. I used to be able to arrive, this is pre-9/11, at my home airport about a half hour before my flight. I could cruise through the plane, cruise through security, get on the plane. Today, I have to arrive about an hour and a half before my flight. So I never know how long it will take me to get through security. I'm grateful for the security, but it comes at a price. It takes longer, costs more. That's the cost of low trust. I recently flew into and out of a high-risk airport in a part of the world where the trust is extremely low for geopolitical reasons. When I left that country, I had to arrive at the airport literally 4 hours before my flight. My bag was then unpacked and repacked a couple of times. I was interrogated a couple of times. And I was treated like everybody else. but the trust was so low, they took great steps to compensate for the lack of trust, for which I was thankful, but it came at a price. It took a lot of time, cost a lot of money. When we had the scandals of Enron and WorldCom, trust in large companies went down and the market went down. Can't have that. U.S. Congress steps in, passes Sarbanes-Oxley. Rules and regulations designed for the lack of trust. It's not trust itself. It's a crutch, a proxy, a prothesis for a lack of trust. But it's a slow-moving and a costly one at that. It takes a lot of time, costs a lot of money. Now let's contrast that, the opposite. When trust goes up, speed goes up, cost comes down. Warren Buffett, he goes into the deal, he extends trust, it goes up. So speed goes up, does the deal in less than a month. Cost goes down, no due diligence cost, instead of spending millions in due diligence. And that's Warren Buffett doing big deals. Let me tell you the story about the donut guy. Here's the classic entrepreneur, because this is the first level entrepreneurship. It's a street vendor. He has a great location where he sets up a stand outside of a major office building in a big city. And he sells donuts and coffee to passersby as they go into work in the morning. He's got a, because of his location, he's got these long lines of people that gather. And he notices that a lot of times people wait in line and they grow impatient of waiting and they just leave and go into the building without being served. He also notices that what's taking him the longest is making change for his customer. So this street vendor decides that he's going to trust his customer. And what he does is he gets a basket. In that basket, he puts dollar bills, $5 bills, tens, nickels, quarters, and dimes. He puts the basket on the edge of the cart. The customer comes through. He serves him donuts and coffee. The customer goes to pay him, and he motions to the customer, "You make your own change." So the customer goes down to the end of the cart, and on their own, into the basket, they make their own change. Now, there's some risk in that, right? Because maybe the customer makes the wrong change, accidentally, or worse, purposefully. But when trust goes up, what goes up with it? Speed. That's exactly what happened. Instantly, he was able to put through twice as many customers as before. See, he never lacked for customers. They would leave. They grew impatient. Now, twice as many customers as before, because he got rid of the bottleneck. He added no new cost in doing that. And here's what he found. Rather than people abusing the trust, he found just the opposite. People liked being trusted. They came back to him more frequently, and they were more loyal to him, and they left him larger than normal tips. And he literally more than doubled his business by simply extending trust to his customer. It's just a very simple illustration of the economics of trust. If you can increase trust, you'll increase speed and decrease cost. There's some risk in that. Got to be smart about it. But there's also huge return to it. There's risk in not doing it. To look at the customers you're losing, not doing it. Now, it applies everywhere, and the data on it is overwhelming. High trust is a dividend, just as surely as low trust is a tax. Here's what the data shows. Trust goes down, speed goes down, cost goes up. Here's the trust dividend. Trust goes up, speed goes up, cost goes down. High trust is a dividend. The data shows that high trust organizations outperform low trust organizations by 286% in total return to shareholders. 286%. There's other data that show this. For instance, in the Fortune magazine study, the 100 best companies to work for in America. To be on this list, you have to have high trust. Trust is 3/5 the criteria. It's the starting place. Because what makes a great place to work is mutual trust. These companies outperform the market by 416%. Four times. So 3 to 4 times. You see it in schools. Tony Brick of Stanford, his data shows this. High trust schools have a 3.5 times greater probability of increasing test scores than do low trust schools. You see it in outsourcing. You see it in relationships. Everything. Trust is a dividend. It's even, I was with a hospital the other day, and people who trust more live longer and are healthier. The dividend is real. High trust is a dividend just as surely as low trust is a tax. Now that brings us to the opportunity. And that opportunity is this. How do we get the trust dividend instead of paying the trust tax? If you're getting taxed now, how can you reduce the tax or eliminate it? Or better yet, convert it into a dividend. That's for you personally or for your team, for your company. If you're already getting a dividend, how can you double the dividend, triple it, tenfold it? Let me show you the how. This is where I'm going to give you a framework for trust and some tools on how you can do this. And if we can go ahead, my friends in the back, we can go ahead and pass out these handouts now. Go ahead and pass out the handouts. Let me walk through a metaphor on trust. Here's the metaphor, the ripple effect. The drop of water comes down and the waves go out. There are two sides to trust, two dimensions. The first, we understand intuitively. That's character. You trust people that have character. People trust you for your character. We get that one. The second one we often don't think about, but it's equally important, and that is competence. We trust people that are also competent. It's not enough to just have the one without the other. You might know someone that you've worked with that's high in character but low in competence. You might trust them to be a good friend, but not necessarily to get the job done. There might be someone in the other direction that's high in competence, very capable, very skilled, but you're questioning and wondering about their character. You're not going to trust them with the money. See, you need both character and competence. When you have both, the fruits of that are that it gives you credibility. It gives you judgment and influence with people. That's the fruit of having both character and competence. So let's take a look at how this works. The drop of water comes down, the ripple effect metaphor. And you got your character, your competence. The first wave of trust, where it all begins, is with self-trust. This is where it starts. You want to build trust? Start here, self-trust. Self-trust means this. Do I trust myself? Do I trust myself? It also means this. Do I give to others a person they can trust? Do I give to others a leader they can trust, an entrepreneur they can trust? Do I trust myself? Do I give to others a person they can trust? We then move to the second level, which is relationship trust. This is now trust with other people. But you can see why it's inside out, because you'll have a hard time sustaining trust with other people if at the end of the day, you don't really even trust yourself. So you always start with yourself. Then you move to your relationships. From there, you move to the organization, organizational trust or team trust, inside out. From there, you move into the marketplace, market trust. This is your reputation, your brand in the marketplace with customers and suppliers and distributors. What does your brand stand for? What does your reputation mean? And from there, you move into society, societal trust. This is the contribution that you make. So five waves of trust. But like the drop of water that comes down, the starting wave is yourself, especially as an entrepreneur. Because this is where you start as an entrepreneur. Do I trust myself, and do I give to others a leader that they can trust, an entrepreneur they can trust? So let's talk about these first two waves of self-trust and relationship trust. Self-trust, here's the key principle. It is, my friends, it is about your credibility. Your credibility. Credibility comes from the Latin term credere, which means to believe. So credibility means believability. Am I believable? Am I credible? If you are, you'll tend to be trusted. And if you're not, you'll tend not to be trusted. It's really that simple. See, credibility and trust are like two sides of the same coin. They're both vital, but credibility is the foundation on which all trust is built. Warren Buffett is able to go into new situations and build trust fast. Why? First, because he's credible. He's believable. He has that foundation. Now, when he behaves in ways that build trust, he can build it fast. Didn't have to take forever. So it is for any entrepreneur. People are gauging, how credible are you? So let me show you four cores or four dimensions of credibility. And these flow out of this character and this competence that I've talked about. I'm going to use another metaphor, the metaphor of a tree. The root system of the tree and the trunk of the tree is your character. It's beneath the surface. Most of it's not seen. Some of it is, but it's not seen until the storm comes. But a character alone by itself is like a tree stump, insufficient. We also have to have the fruits that flow from it. So the other side, the branches of the tree, the fruits, that's like your competence. And by itself, again, is insufficient without the character. What we really want is the combination of both character and competence. So these four cores of credibility, they flow out of your character and your competence. Two cores belong to character, two to competence. If you do these things as an entrepreneur, if your company does these things, you'll be credible, and therefore you can establish trust fast. If you don't, or you don't have these cores in place, the trust will be slow in coming, and you'll pay the taxes for it. So let's take a look at the first core of credibility. First core of credibility is the foundation of integrity. Integrity is referring to your honesty and your truthfulness, but also integrity refers to your congruence. Do you do the things that you say that you value? Are you aligned? Are you congruent? The real test of integrity, the real test is when there's a consequence, where it costs you. Let me illustrate this. A couple years ago, the Italian Masters tennis tournament, Andy Roddick is playing, the American tennis player. It's match point in favor of Roddick. So one more point and Roddick wins the match. Roddick's opponent serves the ball is called out. So Roddick has won. Roddick and his opponent move forward to shake hands. The crowd cheers. The announcer on television says, it's all over now. But as they're walking forward to shake hands, Roddick notices that the ball has landed on, not beyond the line. In other words, it's in, not out. Now, this is a sport in which the umpires make the call. Or now technology is starting to do it, but the players don't. So Roddick has every right to just keep walking forward, shake his hand. He's won the match. It's called out. Roddick doesn't. He sees this. He stops. He pauses. He points out to the umpire. The ball's in, not out. Let's continue to play. So they continue to play. Well, Roddick goes on and loses the match. But while he lost the match, he won something far greater. He not only won integrity, he won credibility, believability, because he'll even make a call against himself. Look how believable that is. Look at that kind of clout that gives him, naturally. Now, let me show you this. I've got actual live footage of this match taking place. You can watch Andy Roddick and watch how he responds to this.
Consider character. In the third round of the Italian Masters, Andy Roddick was paired against Fernando Verdasco. It was match point in favor of Roddick. Verdasco hit the ball, the line judge called it out, and the crowd assumed Roddick had won the match.
Oh, and a double fault call. It's all over. It's not over.
But Roddick pointed out to the umpire a slight indentation on the clay court, which showed that the ball had landed on, not beyond the line. Everyone was amazed. Roddick had made a call against himself, and as a result, he lost the point and he went on to lose the match. But he gained something far greater. He gained credibility and trust. How do you think the umpires are going to respond the next time Andy Roddick challenges a call?
Extraordinary match to witness. He's won a lot of friends.
He's such a great guy on and off the court, and what we saw there just typifies the young man.
So, his integrity yielded credibility, believability. That's the foundation. The real test of integrity is when the storm comes, when there's a consequence, when it costs you. But your reputation goes in front of you. And the more you show that in those moments of truth, that you demonstrate the integrity, that precedes you. Your word becomes your bond. It gets out there in the marketplace. People know that. They can trust you. They can rely upon it. There's an extraordinary advantage, especially when there's a consequence. So you do this not because you get a gain. You do it because it's the right thing to do. And in doing that, you get these wins, these gains. Let me now go to the second core of credibility. The second core of credibility is intent. See, intent is like the trunk of the tree. Integrity is like the roots. You don't really know until the storm comes. Are they there? How strong are they? Intent is like the trunk. Some of it's beneath the surface. Some of it's above. Intent is referring to your motive, to your agenda. And the intent that best builds trust is when your motive is one of caring for those that you're serving, those that you're working with, your customers. You care for them. But also one of mutual benefit. Win-win. You're seeking mutual benefit always. You want them to win as well as yourself. And your behavior is where you act in others' best interests. Jay and I were talking before the program. When people act in others' best interests, it tends to build trust. When you really are focused on your client and their win, it tends to build trust. But if they see you as self-serving, you're just trying to make the deal, do the sale for your sake, and that you're more concerned about you than you are about them, their agenda, their motive, their wins, that tends to diminish the trust. They'll hold it back and there'll be a tax you'll be paying. But when they see you as mutual benefit, win-win, yeah, I know he wants to win, but he wants my win just as much as his own, if not more. And I sense that. I sense that they're acting in my best interest. When your employees feel that, I know that the boss is acting in my best interest. I believe that. I feel it. They trust you. Without that, they don't. You pay a tax. Integrity and intent, those flow out of your credibility, or out of your character, and they make you credible with people. Let's look at the next two cores. These flow from your competence. The third core is capabilities. It's like the branches of the tree that can produce the fruit. Capabilities are your talents, your skills, your expertise, your knowledge that can produce these results. That's for you personally. It's also the same for your company. What is it that you're offering? How expert is it? And what's the important question here is, are you current? Are you relevant? Or have you become obsolete? Companies have to reinvent themselves, recreate themselves. So do leaders. Someone once said, I've got 15 years of experience. I said, that's great. I only have one question for you. Do you have 15 years of experience? Or do you have 1 year of experience repeated 15 times? Big difference. See, we got to be current and relevant. Here you want to think Tiger Woods. Here we are, the week of the Masters. So this is relevant. But Tiger Woods, 11 years ago, he wins the Masters by 12 strokes. And then he changes his swing. Why? He wanted to get better, stay relevant for the long haul. Then he wins, a few years later, 4 major tournaments in a row, and yet changes his swing one more time. Why? He says he wants to get better, stay relevant. He's always improving his capabilities. Now he's winning all these tournaments again. Who knows if he's going to change? The point is, he's always trying to stay relevant and current. So it is for a person, so it is for a leader, an entrepreneur. Are we current? Are we relevant? Or are we only relying upon yesterday's knowledge to solve today's problems? Because we haven't stayed current.